Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents What Your Food Ate, How to Heal Our Land and Reclaim Our Health, by David R. Montgomery and Anne Biklé, read by Laural Merlington. Introduction. Most of us don't think about the soil when we sit down for a meal with friends or family, but we should. We all know that a fresh pear is healthier than a pile of salty potato chips, but it is all too easy to lose sight of another dimension to our health. What's in that pear, and how it got there? How we grow our food? In a world awash in clickbait headlines about what to eat and what to avoid, few know that the typical grocery store carrot now contains less zinc than those our great-grandmothers served their kids, or that the beef sizzling on the barbecue probably packs a lot less iron than what our grandparents ate as children. Reports of troubling nutrient decline span the human diet, from fruits and vegetables to grains, meats, and dairy. And while what we mostly hear in arguments over the future of agriculture centers on differences between organic and conventional farming, the real story is not that simple, and far more interesting. Over the past century, farming practices have changed food in ways that reduced levels of beneficial compounds in our diet, ranging from those in fruits and vegetables that help prevent cancer, to fats in meat and dairy that modulate inflammation. Too many of us have never heard of fats that are good for us, or know that our health suffers when we don't get enough plant-made phytochemicals in our diet. Yet when it comes to lifelong health, an adequate supply of such compounds appears as fundamental as getting enough exercise. There is no shortage of opinions about what we should eat. People argue endlessly, for example, over whether we should eat less meat, more meat, no meat, or meat that isn't meat. What's typically missing from the framing of dietary choices is how we grow what we eat. The way we raise our crops and livestock proves as important as what we choose to eat. We're still learning how soil life helps plants grow and influences the things that end up in their bodies, and thus in our bodies. What role does better soil play in growing a better peach or carrot? If we want the healthiest food, is organic farming good enough? To answer such questions, we need to examine the long-running relationships that all plants develop with a vast menagerie of soil life. You may have heard about the importance of our microbiome, particularly the gut microbiota that dwell in our colon and transform what lands there into compounds that benefit our health. Similarly, the tiniest soil dwellers influence crop health. And what's true in the human body holds true for soil, too. Routinely killing off or disrupting microbial partnerships rarely benefits the host. Soil is the starting point for foods that come from the land, and a groundswell of evidence, observations, and research points to an underappreciated factor contributing to food quality: the health of the soil on farms and ranches. As we'll share ahead, a substantial body of evidence shows that the state of the land influences the health of crops, for better and worse, and the nutritional quality of the pasture, crops, or rangeland that livestock eat strongly influences their health. But does soil health affect human health as well? How much does what your food ate matter to your health? Like beads on a string, we can connect the way farmers treat their soil, grow crops, and feed their livestock to what fills our plates, glasses, and bodies. How we treat the land affects how it, in turn, treats us. Key pillars of today's conventional agriculture, routine plowing and liberal use of chemical fertilizers to grow relatively few high-yielding crops, helped drive the twin problems of degraded soil health and declining nutrients in food. Over the past century, our food lost mineral elements we need in trace amounts, like copper and zinc, and others we need a lot more of, like calcium and magnesium. Today, you'd have to eat several apples a day to keep that proverbial doctor away. These changes didn't happen by design as much by oversight and a single-minded focus on quantity. We've learned a lot in recent decades about the ways crops acquire or get shorted on minerals and other nutrients and compounds important for our health. Out of sight, below-ground communities of symbiotic soil bacteria and fungi work as a nutrient acquisition and intelligence service for plants. And it turns out that farming practices shape these communities and thus the types and amounts of health-promoting minerals, fats, and phytochemicals in our crops, meat, and dairy, and ultimately in our bodies. Phytochemicals are compounds plants make to help them defend themselves, enhance their growth, and communicate. But the go-to practices of mainstream agriculture disrupt the soil microbiome, unleashing modern farming's chemical treadmill. The more farmers come to rely on synthetic inputs instead of beneficial soil life, the more they need the former and lose the latter. Fortunately, as we'll see, there are practical, cost-effective ways for farmers to cultivate soil life and harvest healthier food. But doing so requires thinking differently about the soil. In coming chapters, you'll meet visionaries who long ago foresaw that losing soil life would seed a downward spiral toward less nutritious food and less healthy people. And you'll hear about innovative farmers bringing their land back to life and nutrition back to their harvests. This is a story about the way health flows to us from the land. It matters how we farm, and we needn't choose between what's healthy for the environment and for people. We can feed ourselves in ways that build and safeguard the health of both the land and our bodies. Regenerative farming practices can help stop soil erosion, enhance soil health, and build up soil organic matter, soil carbon. They are catching on among American farmers, allowing them to slash spending on fuel, fertilizers, and pesticides. In effect, farmers who adopt regenerative practices find they can rely on biology to replace most of what they used to buy from agrochemical suppliers. At the same time, consumer demand for more sustainable products incentivizes a growing list of companies integrating regenerative farms into their supply chains. But do these products really prove better for our health, too? Does science back up claims of better food from healthy, fertile soil? And if so, what could regenerative agriculture mean for human nutrition and public health? We tend to think of diet-related ailments as arising from deficiencies in particular nutrients. Take scurvy, for example. If you start consuming vitamin C-rich citrus, scurvy clears right up, as British naval surgeon James Lind demonstrated in a famous 1749 medical trial aboard HMS Salisbury. Some cures are this simple. But curing other types of ailments and maintaining good health in the first place are far more complex. And on this point, the mix of foods in the human diet matters because phytochemicals, minerals, fats, and other compounds in food interact synergistically. And the fact that farming practices influence all of them leaves us with an unsettling question. How good really is modern agriculture for our health? Of course, we're not arguing that food grown in degraded soil is the cause of all the worrisome health trends humanity faces. To be sure, our health, good, bad, and in between, reflects a constellation of interacting factors, from our genes, diet, physical activity level, and microbiome to personal and maternal exposure to toxins and pathogens in the environments where we live, work, and play. Also, the dramatic rise in the onset and types of chronic diseases over the past century is partly attributable to more comprehensive diagnosis and monitoring. But given recent advances in our understanding of the human immune system, as well as in our healing and aging processes, it's time to take a fresh look at whether mainstream agricultural practices fill our crops and livestock with all our bodies need to support robust health. A key reason so few of us are aware of nutrient declines in food is that society remains fixated on an ancient challenge we've almost, if perhaps only temporarily, solved: growing enough to feed us all. While access to sufficient food remains a conspicuous problem for far too many, hidden hunger lurks beneath the surface of the modern sea of cheap, plentiful calories flooding the westernized world. Focusing on yields, like bushels per acre, pounds of an animal, and gallons of milk, is laudable. It helps fill bellies and pay farmers. But quantities harvested tell us nothing about whether those foods contain enough of the right mix of nutrients to help us grow when young and imbue us with health throughout life, especially as we age. Honed through the slow-burning fires of evolution, our bodies developed an innate nutritional wisdom. Deeply embedded in our biology, it works like a compass guiding us toward a healthy diet. Along the way, our senses of touch, smell, and taste helped answer the question of what to eat or not to eat. About half our brain is dedicated to processing, filtering, and interpreting what we see. And what food looked and tasted like contained clues we relied on to guide us to nutrition. These days, however, relying on our nutritional wisdom to judge the quality of food in a modern grocery store is a fraught proposition. We've all experienced the disappointment of biting into a gorgeous yet mealy peach or a shiny, mushy apple. Modern marketing and the ubiquity of highly processed foods further confuse and misdirect our inherent nutritional wisdom. Like candy for the eye, highly processed foods in colorful packages adorned with mouth-watering images lure us to overload on seductively flavored yet empty calories. In addition, crop breeders generally favor selecting for yield, harvest convenience, shipping, and storage, rather than flavor and nutrition. No wonder many of us increasingly question what's in our food, what might be missing, and why. So what's a health-conscious consumer to do? Does an organic diet provide an easy answer? Not necessarily. As we'll see, one can't always rely on the familiar green and white organic label to deliver nutrient-rich food. Most organic farmers are not so different from conventional farmers when it comes to agriculture's most iconic act: plowing. And running a plow through a living ecosystem is much like having a tornado strike your home. In the case of soil-dwelling organisms that plants rely on, they suffer and their house falls apart. In addition, other practices that have been fought over but are now allowed under the organic label, like soilless hydroponic production and confined dairy and chicken operations, do not necessarily deliver the nutrition or animal welfare that most consumers equate with organic food. There are also many reasons beyond the kitchen to care about how we grow our food. After all, the long arm of modern agriculture stretches beyond farms, contributing to downstream water pollution and climate change. Moreover, the health and well-being of those who work on farms remain social justice issues that should concern us all. Adopting farming practices that are better for the land at large, and soil health specifically, would help address these related problems as well. Must we choose between quantity and quality? Or can we grow enough to nourish us all? Could healing sick soil through regenerative agriculture restore fertility to the land, help heal an ailing populace, and enhance our quality of life? Defined broadly, regenerative farming practices are those that build soil organic matter and support soil life in ways that enhance and maintain fertility over time. Our journey asking questions and writing about connections between people, agriculture, and health began 3 books ago. The first, Dirt, The Erosion of Civilizations, investigates the role of soil erosion and degradation in limiting the lifespan of past societies. The Hidden Half of Nature shares the new science of microbiomes in plants and people, revealing the striking parallels between the soil and the human gut that point to much-needed changes in agriculture and medicine. The third, Growing a Revolution, takes this new science and the lessons of history to explore how regenerative farming can rebuild soil health, stash carbon below ground, and greatly reduce agrochemical use. While these prior books respectively map onto history, science, and solutions, you can listen to them in any order, or start with this one. Through the eyes and experience of a geologist, Dave, and a biologist, Anne, we'll delve into how farming practices ripple from soil to plant to animal to us, navigating the tangled history and science behind our relationship with the land. We re-examine beliefs about health, medicine, our bodies, and their intersection with food and farming. Along the way, we'll explore fields from agronomy and microbiology to environmental and nutritional science, as well as bovine and human biology. Insights linking these fields show how and why regenerative farming practices can heal the soil, bring life back to the land, and grow the nutrient-dense and flavor-packed foods we need to reclaim our health. Once you understand the connections, it becomes clear that for plants, animals, and people alike, the roots of health grow from healthy soil. 1. The Edible Puzzle. It is health that is real wealth. Mahatma Gandhi. Both hope and hype swirl around using food as medicine today. Yet the more we learn, the more a healthy diet comes into focus as a solid foundation for preventing and potentially treating chronic diseases. But this isn't really a new idea. Around 400 BCE, the Greek physician generally credited with bringing reason into medicine advocated a nutritious diet as the best defense against sickness and disease. In his list of questions that a doctor should always ask, Hippocrates included where a patient's food came from. He saw what one ate and the nature of the soil it grew in as essential pieces in the puzzle of health, good or bad. As Western medicine sidelined Hippocrates's view, it proved remarkably adept at developing effective treatments and cures for acute maladies and many of the worst infectious diseases. Our grandparents feared scourges like typhoid and scarlet fever that we know now only as haunting names. But the nature of illness radically shifted over time as public health measures reduced the incidence of infectious diseases through water supply treatment, antibiotics, and vaccines. Today, however, illnesses unfamiliar to past generations plague us more than ever. We improved our medical prowess only to face escalating rates of chronic diseases and autoimmune conditions that now afflict many Americans. What happened? Genetics, of course, helps explain why some people are more or less prone to particular maladies. But it doesn't fully account for the rapid rise of modern chronic diseases. Our genes don't change that fast. What did? What we eat and how we grow it. Over the course of the 20th century, we shifted from a diet of whole foods to one low in fiber, rich in sugar, and heavily processed food, and grown with a lot of synthetic fertilizer and agrochemicals. It increasingly appears that, although unintended, these dietary and farming changes undermined public health. As agriculture chased calories over nutritional quality, food processing radically reshaped food, and medical research focused on developing new treatments and drugs over investigating the role of diet in preventing disease. Shifting wisdom. Scan the health and diet section of any bookstore or peruse Amazon's top-selling nutrition titles, and you may be left wondering what's actually okay to eat. Books about diets and dieting generally push the idea that the path to good health follows eating the right foods and avoiding the wrong foods. Diets like paleo, keto, and vegan incompatibly emphasize eating certain foods and going heavy or light on carbs, protein, or fats. Across the board, dietary advice typically focuses on what and how much to eat, with remarkably little attention paid to how farming practices influence the nutritional quality of food and whether the right foods pack the nutrients they once had. Just as what we eat has changed over time, so too has our understanding of what makes for a healthy diet. Nutritional wisdom shifted as we learned there is more to diet than just calories and the simple distinction of fats, carbs, and protein. It turns out that fats are not really all that fattening, and too much sugar messes with our metabolism and gets stored as, you guessed it, fat. Because genes and microbiomes differ between individuals and nutritional needs change over a lifetime, there is no one best diet for all people. Despite this inherent variability, diet remains the foundation for good health. New science about the human microbiome is also part of the evolving understanding around the influence of diet on human health and well-being. Our gut microbes dine on fiber and other compounds in food, producing an array of metabolites, many of which our bodies need. That roughly 40% of the molecules circulating through our bodies arise directly or indirectly from our gut microbiota adds a new dimension linking diet to health. As we'll see, what our gut microbiota eat helps explain the now standard nutritional wisdom of a diet loaded with fruits and vegetables. Millions of years ago, our earliest primate ancestors ate a fruit-heavy diet. Later, prehumans chewed all day on fibrous roots and plants, prepping them for microbiota in the lower reaches of the gut to further digest. Over the ages, we evolved and thrived together with our tiny tenants, giving them food and shelter in exchange for nourishment and microbial metabolites that enhanced our health. When our pre-human ancestors started using fire to cook food, their bodies began changing. Primatologist Richard Wrangham argues that the adoption of cooking around 1.8 million years ago led to the development of Homo erectus, a theory he bases on changes observed in pre-human anatomy during that time. Though the earliest date remains controversial, most researchers seem to agree that our ancestors controlled fire by around 500,000 years ago. Over countless generations, the more efficient nutrient uptake that came with the shift from raw to cooked foods led to reallocating energy previously used for digestion to grow and power our brain. Cooking also helped our early ancestors integrate meat into their diet when they could get it. Another major change in the human diet occurred around 10,000 years ago. In the post-glacial world, we transitioned from hunting and gathering to growing food and raising animals, to agriculture. Herding animals ensured a steady supply of meat that didn't involve a day-long perilous journey tracking, killing, and hauling. And livestock came with the bonus of milk to consume fresh on the spot or ferment into yogurt or cheese, providing short-term storage of nutritious, flavorful food. Livestock also produced manure, a powerful natural fertilizer that helped crops grow. Herding and farming fed more people more reliably than hunting and gathering. The crops that dramatically reshaped our post-glacial diet were not leafy greens, but calorie and nutrient-rich grains that stored well and provided year-round meals. This meant few could feed many, opening the door for occupational specialization and the rise of large, increasingly complex civilizations. The most recent modern shift in what we eat and how we grow it changed the game, especially for our gut microbiota. In reducing our ration of fermentable fiber, we reduced theirs, not fully understanding that this scuttled the production of microbial metabolites our bodies evolved to rely on. In addition, introducing novel additives and chemicals into food impacts the human microbiome and us in ways we are only now realizing. Likewise, modern farming methods changed relationships between soil life, crops, and livestock. How much has all this affected our health? More than we bargained for. The yield trap. Talk to farmers for long enough, and sooner or later you'll hear something like, "If it's not in the bin, it doesn't matter." What they mean is that bushels and pounds sold pay the bills. And while tonnage that translates into cheap, abundant food sounds like good news for a hungry world, it is not necessarily good for our health. So how did we reach this awkward point? Astounding harvests of lower nutritional quality. After the Second World War, farmers increasingly relied on mechanized plowing, chemical fertilizers, and pesticides to reap high crop yields. The effects were seductive and addictive. Greater yields despite degraded fields. Society equated this edible bounty with human health for good reason. Time and again throughout history, famine reduced our numbers. The high yields of modern agriculture seemed miraculous against this backdrop given our rapidly growing population. Today, the Western world stands lifetimes removed from mass starvation. Globally, we grow enough to feed everyone if distribution were equitable. Yet it is well known in agricultural circles that breeding crops for high yields and easier harvesting, processing, and shipping reduced nutritional quality. It is no secret that processing wheat into white flour strips the grain of nutrition. And it doesn't help if nutrients do not get into food in the first place. Our tendency to believe more is better, to want a larger apple, a bigger tomato, supersized wheat grains, and more milk per cow, led us to see calories as a stand-in for nutrition. But we neglected to pay attention to what may be missing from those calories, even as we learned there is more to health than sufficient calories. Many of the chronic diseases and ailments that plague us today are linked to diet. Our knowledge of what makes for a good diet expanded beyond a full belly once we discovered that non-caloric things in food like vitamins and minerals also play key roles in good health. Vitamins and certain minerals are often referred to as micronutrients, reflecting that we need them in small amounts. And so although we may not need much of the mineral element copper, for example, that little bit is central to the workings of our immune system. Yet we can't eat ore, raw metal, or pennies. We have to get copper in our food. Without it or other mineral micronutrients such as zinc, iron, manganese, and selenium, health suffers. Globally, micronutrient malnutrition is now more common than inadequate calories. Iron deficiency afflicts an estimated 2 billion people. Zinc deficiency affects at least a fifth of humanity and is particularly high in sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia. Almost a third of the U.S. population is deficient in at least one vitamin, and almost a quarter lacks sufficient iron. A high proportion of children and adolescents rely on foods that have minerals added. Yet even with such fortified food and supplements, many Americans do not consume recommended levels of vitamins and minerals. For example, a majority of us don't get enough magnesium. Less than a third of Americans get enough vitamin D, and the problem is worse among children and teens. Unfortunately, most Americans live with the hidden hunger of a diet rich in calories but poor in micronutrients and phytochemicals. Far too many of us remain poorly nourished despite eating more than enough food. By the second half of the 20th century, heart disease, hypertension, and type 2 diabetes became common life-shortening health conditions. 7 out of 10 Americans now die of chronic diseases, and around half of us live with at least one such disease. Once rare autoimmune disorders fill out a slate of modern ailments that plague the Western world, from asthma and digestive issues to certain types of cancer and neurological ailments, like autism and Alzheimer's. All told, chronic illnesses exact an immeasurable toll on individuals and their families in declining quality of life, hardship, and frustration. The costs are staggering. As of 2016, treating chronic diseases consumed 3/4 of the approximately $3.3 trillion spent annually on healthcare in the United States, about $5,000 per American. Pharmaceuticals are the treatment for nearly all chronic diseases, and in 2014, American doctors prescribed $374 billion worth of them. That averages out to roughly $1,000 for every man, woman, and child in America. And though we spend about twice as much on healthcare per capita than other developed countries do, we, and our kids, land near the bottom of the heap on common health metrics. Even our longevity lags behind peer nations. The sobering reality is that today's children are the first generation in our nation's history expected to live shorter, less healthy lives than their parents. That's not progress. One of the most significant drivers of chronic health conditions is being overweight or obese for a substantial part of life, as it compromises nearly every major system of the human body. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention reports that more than 2/3 of Americans are overweight and 4 out of 10 are obese. Our kids aren't faring well either. Since 1970, the number of obese adolescents tripled and the number of obese children quadrupled. By some estimates, obesity-related illnesses now account for more than 1 in 5 healthcare dollars Americans spend. While the percentage of income spent on food fell by half since the 1950s, the societal cost of healthcare more than doubled. Our century-long experiment with conventional agriculture seems to have left us better fed than ever in terms of calories consumed, but reeling from a slew of chronic diseases. Maybe cheap food isn't so cheap after all. Our obsession with a calorie-centric view of food has led us to undervalue other components in our diet, especially micronutrients and phytochemicals. Vitamins form parts of enzymes essential to a wide range of normal cell functions. Other micronutrients like zinc support immune system activity and are critical to hundreds of enzymatic reactions in our bodies. Particular phytochemicals activate genes that slow or prevent the onset and progression of chronic diseases. Unfortunately, modern crops and the Western diet shortchange us on these essentials for health. Micronutrients tied to human health play similar roles in animal health, and cows and other ruminants have a strategy for getting the right amount. Given the chance, they'll eat a wide range of different plant forages. Such diversity allows them to select a diet that helps head off or correct nutritional imbalances and deficiencies. And as we'll see, what cows eat ripples through to the nutritional quality of the meat, milk, and cheese we consume. A century ago, the typical Western diet mostly consisted of some meat and minimally processed plant foods grown with few, if any, chemicals. Today, it consists of a lot more meat from animals raised in unsavory settings and highly processed plant foods rich in simple sugars and vegetable oils grown with a lot of agrochemicals and synthetic fertilizers. The average American now eats almost 5 times more calories from added fats and sweeteners than from fruits and vegetables, taking in over 150 pounds of sugar a year, much of it from corn syrup. Although Americans consume almost a quarter more calories a day than in 1961, we're eating far less whole fresh food, with only 1 in 10 Americans actually eating the recommended daily amount of fruits and vegetables. All in all, more than half the calories filling up Americans and Canadians now come from ultra-processed foods. Perhaps we should recast Hippocrates' advice and think of food as preventive medicine, as a way to cultivate and safeguard health so as to avoid the need for routine medications in the first place. Most of us take stock of our health only when we lose it or something threatens it. The same goes for the health or fertility of the land that feeds us. We tend to take our health and that of the soil for granted when good, and when they falter, enterprising folks in medicine and agriculture vie to sell us products to manage symptoms. Many have heard advice to eat real food, to not eat too much, and to keep physically active. But this leaves out another piece in the puzzle of health. Do the foods we eat contain enough of what our bodies need? Surprisingly, little effort has gone toward tracking how farming practices affect the nutritional profile of food. It is generally left to proponents of organic practices to argue that the way we grow food affects our health, beyond the obvious point that conventional foods have more pesticide residue. But there is more to it. The roots of many chronic diseases and autoimmune disorders trace to inflammation, and food choices can either promote or quell chronic inflammation. A diet scant in whole and minimally processed plant foods, like vegetables and whole grains, delivers too few antioxidants and other compounds, including phytochemicals and certain vitamins that help keep inflammation at normal levels. And depending on how farm animals are raised, meat, dairy, and eggs also provide important sources of anti-inflammatory compounds. Conversely, certain foods contribute to inflammation or lack antioxidant power, like refined carbohydrates, sugar, highly processed meats, and many vegetable oils, as well as particular trans fat that do not occur in nature and only recently entered our diet in processed foods. Changing course is remarkably simple on one level. Overall, we need to eat less but more nutritious food. This encapsulates the concept of nutrient density, the ratio of nutrients to calories. We all have some idea of what makes for nutrient-dense food. A white flour cookie or cake loaded with sugar-rich frosting is not nutrient-dense. A whole wheat cracker topped with hummus is. So how do we grow nutrient-dense food packed with phytochemicals and nutrients like essential minerals and fats? Healthy soil. Soil health offers a clarifying lens for understanding the effects of farming practices on human health, as it cuts through the usual arguments about conventional versus organic farming. Industrialized organic farms can destroy fertile soil as surely as thoughtful conventional farmers can rebuild the health of their fields. About a third of the world's agricultural land suffers from serious topsoil erosion or reduced fertility that compromises the well-being of at least 3.2 billion people. As if that's not alarming enough, a 2015 United Nations assessment concluded we remain on track to degrade the productive capacity of our planet's agricultural land by about another third over the coming century if farming practices continue to damage the soil. The way we grow our food, what we've been doing to the land, is undermining civilization's agricultural foundation and the health of us all. On farms around the world, the loss of topsoil and the carbon-rich organic matter on which soil life thrives constitutes an underappreciated global disaster that underscores an odd reality. Today's harvests would dazzle our ancestors. How is it that we can grow more food from worse soil? So far, mineral and synthetic fertilizers, along with the chemicals farmers buy to kill weeds and pests, have compensated for beat-up, ailing soil. Yet no matter what you may think about industrial agriculture, we cannot simply pin poor soil health on modern farming. After all, Rome's farmers managed to devastate the soils of central Italy, Syria, and Libya long before agrochemicals existed. How? By plowing too much and too often. While they used manure to boost harvests, persistent tillage eroded the fertility of their land right out from under them over the long run. For millennia, farmers around the world have done things to ensure future crops, from praying or offering sacrifices in hope of better harvests, to adopting practices that boost fertility. African, Asian, European, and Native American farmers all learned the value of rotating or co-planting different crops and discovered the restorative power of growing legumes like peas, beans, clover, and alfalfa. Over time, traditional farming practices in different regions came to include planting cover crops and letting livestock manure harvested fields. These practices solidified into traditions because they enhanced soil fertility. They worked, at least for a while. But such practices, especially when done inconsistently or poorly, do not stop water and wind from stripping soil off of bare plowed fields. Time and again, field after field and region after region lost its fertile topsoil. Yet soil loss usually played out gradually enough to forestall urgency in addressing it. Widespread soil degradation drove farmers to use, and later wholly rely on, chemical fertilizers as well as pesticides developed for killing insects, weeds, and fungi. These new products increased yield so well that traditional soil husbandry practices that once maintained fertility were neglected, sidelined, or abandoned. A harvest-obsessed world chased progress down the agrochemical highway. Now, with billions more people to feed, the soil on much of the world's farm and ranch land stands in far worse shape than under nature's stewardship. With conventional practices continuing to degrade the land, agriculture will change over the coming century, one way or another, The question is how. This unfolding disaster also presents an opportunity to rebuild soil health and realize the great promise of agriculture, harvesting both quantity and quality. Just what is soil health? The U.S. Department of Agriculture, USDA, defines it as the continued capacity of soil to function as a vital living ecosystem that sustains plants, animals, and humans. The idea is rooted in the central role that soil life plays in the processes that cycle nitrogen and other elements of soil into crops, livestock, and people. Indeed, life distinguishes soil from dirt. Ailing soil leads farmers to depend on measures other than natural soil biology and chemistry to grow abundant crops. The uncomfortable reality is that most of the world's farmland is sick, and increasingly, so are we, as farmers prop up harvest with fertilizers and pesticides, and consumers depend on pharmaceuticals to combat uniquely modern chronic diseases. Turning the tide on the historical trend of land degradation will take combining ancient wisdom with modern science to develop and adapt highly productive farming practices that rebuild soil organic matter and restore fertility to degraded fields. Toward this end, a regenerative agriculture movement is rapidly growing, based in part on recognition that farmers harvest higher profits when they restore soil health and spend less on fuel, fertilizer, and pesticides. That healthy soil helps conventional farmers spend less for inputs and still harvest comparable yields, produces a buzz at farming conferences across America's heartland, as well as among climate activists. Farmers who boost their soil's organic matter use photosynthesis to pull carbon out of the atmosphere and make it available below ground, where it can feed soil life essential to crop health. Another area of growing interests centers on whether regenerative farmers raise more nutrient-dense food. In asking this question, we can look back through history for guidance. Decades ago, soil scientist William Albrecht proposed looking at the relationship between soil health and human health as a pyramid. He saw soil health as the foundation for plant health, which supported animal health and ultimately human health. Pioneering organic farming proponent J.I. Rodale laid it out as a simple equation. Healthy soil equals healthy crops equals healthy people. While it remains challenging to connect soil health and human health so directly, we'll break it down along these lines to explore the individual links from soil health to crop health to livestock health, and both to human health. Where to begin? Where else but from the ground up, with how life in the soil helps plants eat rocks to build green bodies? Soil. 2. Rocks become you. All things come from earth, and all things end by becoming earth. Xenophanes. Imagine walking into a grocery store and scanning the carrots with a handheld device to measure which of them has the most potassium or beta-carotene. Sound like something out of Star Trek? Not anymore. Such a device, the bio-nutrient meter, could kick open the door to greater consumer knowledge, choice, and empowerment. It's the brainchild of Dan Kittredge, founder of the Bio-Nutrient Food Association. The instrument shines a light with a known spectrum of frequencies onto an object and measures what bounces back. The spectral signature is a bit like a fingerprint. The device compares the spectral signature of, for example, a carrot on a store shelf to spectral data in an archival library of carrots with known values of specific nutrients. This real-time assessment would then allow a consumer to pick the best of the bunch. The idea has been used for decades with satellites in mineral exploration, and Kittredge's team cleverly adapted the technology to make a handy device to scan food. When they began test driving their gizmo on spinach and carrots, they found a tremendous range in both mineral and phytochemical content. Mineral levels varied by 4 to 18-fold, depending on the mineral. Conservatively, that means a high-quality spinach leaf or carrot could have the nutritional value of at least 4 low-quality spinach leaves or carrots. The variation was even greater in terms of antioxidants and polyphenols, important for human health, with the most nutrient-dense carrots and spinach containing up to 200 times more than the least. But before they can usher in this new era of consumer empowerment, the BioNutrient Food Association needs to build out its database. This will take time, of course. Nonetheless, Kittredge sees consumers eventually armed with the ability to test and compare the nutritional quality of food while shopping as a game changer in reshaping agriculture. Getting into you. Whatever the specific mineral deficiencies are among carrots or any other crop, they do have one thing in common. For minerals to get into us, they first have to move out of the soil and into the plants and animals that become our food. So how do plants eat? This deceptively simple question took centuries to answer. At first, most of the few who thought about such matters believed plants consumed decaying organic matter in the soil, that plants ate humus. Then, in the early 1800s, the discovery that photosynthesis enabled plants to fuel their growth through combining water with carbon dioxide from the atmosphere upended the accepted view. Later experiments established that only part of what makes up humus is soluble and therefore available to plants in the water they draw up through their roots. These discoveries opened the door for a radically new chemistry-centric view of the soil that still dominates conventional thinking 2 centuries later. In short, adding soluble chemicals to the soil proved an efficient and convenient method for getting the nutrients that are key to growth: nitrogen, N, phosphorus, P, and potassium, K, into plants. The carbon in plants, people, and other life forms enters the biological realm through photosynthesis. With the exception of a few other elements, notably nitrogen, everything else in living things originally came from rocks or soil, as generations of microbes and plant life tapped these sources to build their bodies. Complex molecules essential to all life, like enzymes and proteins, require additional elements, including phosphorus, potassium, calcium, magnesium, and sulfur, to round out plant, animal, and human biomass. Some are abundant in common rocks, others less so. Not coincidentally, along with nitrogen, these are the elements commonly found in major mineral fertilizers. Organic matter, being the remains of once living things, contains the full range of elements essential to life. So once integrated into biological systems, they circulate through nature's grand cycle of life, death, decay, and rebirth, getting passed around and down through successive generations. Nitrogen is the geological odd man out among the elements life needs in abundance. It is rare in rocks, yet essential for plants as they need it to make amino acids that assemble into proteins. And protein, of course, makes up a lot of our bodies, including the muscles that move us, antibodies, enzymes, and other molecules fundamental to our biochemistry. Oddly enough, Plants and people alike bathe in nitrogen day in and day out as it makes up almost 80% of Earth's atmosphere. But an incredibly stable triple bond holds the two atoms of a gaseous nitrogen molecule together. These atomic twins don't like to separate or play with other elements. This makes atmospheric nitrogen pretty inert. Plants cannot simply pull it into their leaves through photosynthesis as they do with carbon dioxide. Instead, nitrogen gets into living things through the work of specialized soil-dwelling bacteria that can crack its powerful bond and combine the individual liberated nitrogen atoms with hydrogen or oxygen to make highly soluble ammonia or nitrates. Lightning strikes are another source of nitrates formed in soils. Plants also require minor amounts of more than a dozen other mineral elements, like copper, iron, manganese, and zinc. These micronutrients do an enormous number of things in plants. Familiar ones, like iron and zinc, are important for the growth and development of fruits and vegetables. The not-so-familiar tongue twister, molybdenum, helps plants use nitrogen and turn sunlight into carbohydrates. If the soil is short on mineral elements needed in larger amounts, like calcium or sulfur, or on micronutrients, adding more can boost growth and harvests. We can't eat rocks, obviously, but we can eat what eats rocks. The green bodies of plants, as well as plant-eating animals. And the mineral micronutrients in their bodies have make-or-break functions in our bodies. Zinc, for example, helps wounds heal and the immune system defeat infections. It is central to the proper working of our senses of taste and smell. Copper is essential for normal heart, lung, and immune system function, as well as cellular respiration and iron metabolism. And iron is key to making the hemoglobin that enables our red blood cells to carry oxygen around our bodies. Consider that the difference between chlorophyll and hemoglobin is one atom out of 143 composing each molecule. Magnesium anchors the structure of chlorophyll. Iron anchors hemoglobin, and not having enough of it causes anemia. If farming methods limit levels of iron or other elements getting into crops, they affect what's getting into us, too. Mineral elements also play important roles in folding organic molecules like enzymes into different shapes. And all these different shaped molecules translate into functional versatility that bridges chemistry and biology. In this way, mineral elements work like the specialty pieces in a Lego set. You can only do so much with tiny bricks. Yet it takes just a couple of specialty pieces to put a whole new twist on possible combinations and shapes. Micronutrients open the door to making enzymes that direct cellular maintenance and are critical for health, even though we only need small amounts of them relative to the other elements that build our tissues and fuel our cells. Phosphorus is a particularly important element that plants and animals need. It is the second most abundant mineral element in your body, a key part of DNA and cell membranes, critical for building bones and teeth, and a must-have for how our bodies use and store energy. But it is naturally quite scarce in most rocks, and therefore in mineral soil. Most unhelpfully for plants, phosphorus in the soil readily oxidizes to form stable, rather insoluble, compounds. So what little is present generally sits parked in the geological realm, locked out of biological circulation. Yet just as for nitrogen, there is another source of phosphorus and other mineral elements critical to life. Dead things, organic matter. It just takes microbial partners to mine and deliver it. Tiny partners. Nature long ago figured out how to recycle vital mineral elements back into living things. The soil is where this happens. Consider that nobody fertilized tropical jungles, the native prairies of the Great Plains, or old-growth rainforests of the Pacific Northwest. Yet the lush growth of plants in all these environments relies on getting both major and minor elements out of the soil and into their bodies through roots that only reach so far. How do they manage? Trillions of tiny allies. Soil-dwelling bacteria and fungi are the worker bees of the subterranean world. They produce enzymes and organic acids that release the minerals held in rocks and organic matter for plants to take up. And when soil fungi and bacteria consume organic matter, they and the creatures that in turn eat them metabolize and convert their meals into soluble nutrients that plants can take back up and use again. In this way, soil microbes act as a procurement and supply system for plants, particularly for less commonly mobile mineral elements like phosphorus, iron, and zinc. Ingesting and digesting food breaks it down to molecular building blocks our bodies reassemble into our cells and tissues. At one level, that's the whole biological point of eating. We get quite a bit of help from our gut microbiome. In contrast, land plants handle digestion outside of their bodies, relying on the soil microbiome to serve as an external stomach, prepping as well as supplying many of the nutrients and compounds plants need to build their bodies. And the minerals that soil microbes help make available to plants set what gets into our crops and the animals that in turn eat them. Consider zinc. Different soils will have different amounts, but none will have a lot. Mycorrhizal fungi serve as root extensions for plants, locating and extracting it from soil particles and organic matter to hand over to plants. A single shovelful of soil can contain miles of thinner-than-a-thread fungal hyphae, making for a vast underground nutrient mining and transportation system. Not all soil-dwelling fungi attach themselves directly to plant roots. Non-mycorrhizal types specialize in decomposing organic matter, which releases nutrients in forms plants can readily take up. Many crops, including wheat, corn, rice, soybeans, potatoes, bananas, yams, flax, and coffee, form partnerships with mycorrhizal fungi. Why would fungi help plants take up minerals like zinc? Fungi themselves can't photosynthesize, so they make trades with plants. Zinc for sun-made foods. Such exchanges occur in the wild frontier beneath our feet in a place called the rhizosphere, from the Greek rhiza, meaning root. This halo-like zone extends from a few millimeters to a centimeter or so around each and every root and root hair. It's a lively place. The soil immediately around plant roots hosts a grand and busy bazaar with nutritious meals for microbes exuding from the roots of a plant into the rhizosphere. Mycorrhizal fungi and soil-dwelling bacteria lap up these exudates and in return give plants nutrients and metabolites that boost botanical growth and defense. Mycorrhizal fungi also convey underground signals to plants that help tee up defenses to repel pathogens, like those that cause tomato blight. Some fungi even help plants share nutrients. The benefits plants receive for stocking the rhizosphere with exudates underpins the botanical world's healthcare plan. For robust growth and health, both plants and people need a full slate of macro and micronutrients. Commercial fertilizers, however, tend to supply only macronutrients, like the standard trio of nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, calcium and sulfur in gypsum, or calcium and magnesium in pulverized limestone, chalk. Such mineral and synthetic fertilizers do spur crop growth, a lot, especially in degraded soils. Nitrogen fertilizers in particular boost yield and protein content. But as the agronomic trinity of mechanized tillage, agrochemicals, and monocultures radically altered how we grew food, it disrupted connections central to how soil life acquires and delivers mineral elements to plants. It stands to reason that disrupting ancient relationships in the rhizosphere profoundly influences the movement of micronutrients into crops. This in turn affects what gets passed on to livestock and into us. If nutrients are low or lacking in crops, we and other animals get shorted too. The value of soil microbes for soil health is now coming into sharper focus for agronomists long trained to prioritize chemical solutions over fostering long-running symbiotic relationships between crops and soil life. People considered fungal mycorrhizae an inconsequential curiosity when first discovered. But by the 1930s, the importance of soil life to plants started coming into focus. One of the first academic researchers to recognize the botanical importance of microbes was Selman Waksman, a Rutgers University professor who coined the term antibiotic after discovering that a soil bacterium could produce what became the wonder drug, streptomycin. In their 1931 book, The Soil and the Microbe, Waksman and co-author Robert Starkey described the key role soil microbes play in decomposing once-living matter, a process that keeps elements circulating from soil to plants and animals and back again. Although Waksman began to appreciate what soil bacteria and fungi did for plants, why microbes did it remained cryptic. It was only decades later that deciphering the chemical language between plants and microbes unveiled complex interactions central to negotiating the challenges of the botanical world's stuck-in-place lifestyle. Understanding reciprocity in an agricultural context means understanding that carbon is the main currency in nature's underground economy. It makes up about half of soil organic matter. The exudates that flow out of the plant's roots into the rhizosphere are another source of carbon. Since soil as a whole is carbon poor relative to the rhizosphere, most soil microbes live in or very close to the rhizosphere. The specific organic compounds and mixtures that plants release into the soil, sugars, proteins, organic acids, vitamins, enzymes, and even fats, attract specific microbes to colonize the rhizosphere. These recruits are a diverse lot. Some physically block pathogen access to roots. Others produce antimicrobials that drive away specific pathogens. In so doing, plants actively recruit and support communities of microbes instrumental to their own well-being, establishing relationships that lie at the heart of plant and crop health. Dead plant tissues like leaves, stems, and roots that make up organic matter are another part of the underground economy, as are dead bacteria, fungi, and other microbes. But conventional farming practices, especially tillage, cause soil organic matter to break down at a rapid pace. A 1994 study in Nature reported that fields in tropical regions could only be tilled economically for less than a decade. After that, so little organic matter remains that supplemental fertilization is required. Likewise, the natural productivity of temperate prairie soils typically lasts just over half a century under regular tillage. When the rate at which carbon is released from soil organic matter races ahead of the ability of soil life to reincorporate it into more biomass, the excess carbon doesn't just disappear. It heads skyward. A late 1970s study found a third of the carbon added to the atmosphere since the Industrial Revolution came from degrading organic matter in agricultural soils. So far, North America's farmland has lost about half of its natural endowment of soil organic matter. Roughly the same goes for agricultural soils globally. As organic matter and the soil life it supports are key to maintaining fertility over the long run, the acute loss of so much from soils around the world threatens to unravel a foundational thread running through the tapestry of life. The complex exchanges and interactions occurring below ground between plants and soil life are as intricate and finely wrought as the relationships between plants and pollinators, familiar to us above ground. Historically, biologists tended to emphasize competition, embodied in Tennyson's famous line about nature red in tooth and claw. But more recent discoveries in microbiome science and ecology have led to new realizations. Symbioses are far more common and widespread than once thought. In this light, the rhizosphere shines as a dynamic living shield that protects and provides for all involved. Obviously, microbes don't have intentions, good or bad. They are brainless, single-celled organisms, after all. But they can be good in the sense that certain microbial communities are essential to the health of plants and people. It turns out that the vast majority of microbes either do us no harm or help us in some way. But good microbes, like opportunistic political allies, will only hold up their end of a relationship as long as interests align. They can turn on their host if circumstances change, as with a plant that fails to hold up its end of the deal to supply exudates. When we repeatedly create an ecological blank slate through routine, indiscriminate use of broad-spectrum biocides in agriculture, we knock back a complex microbial ecosystem that provides an awful lot of benefits. The same goes for overuse of antibiotics in medicine. And whether in the soil or the human gut, weedy species rebound first when given the chance to repopulate our fields and bodies. Where has our century-long war on microbes landed us? We tamed many infectious diseases, but now face superbugs and a modern plague of autoimmune and chronic diseases. On farms, parallel developments led to increasing reliance on pesticides to counter pest outbreaks arising from flagging soil fertility. All that progress left us hooked on pharmaceuticals and agrochemicals. What would a different frontline strategy look like? One that could preserve the effectiveness of antibiotics and pesticides for when we truly need them. One option is cultivating the microbial allies that benefit us when we partner with them. We can look to evolutionary history for perspective on why fungi and plants form partnerships. When plants first came ashore, more than 400 million years ago, their roots served mostly as an anchor, while fungi provided them with minerals from the soil. How do we know? Early fossil land plants have mycorrhizal fungi entwined with their primitive roots. While fertilizers have kept crop yields high enough for us to overlook the problem of declining soil organic matter, we now understand the consequences. Starving soil microbial communities of sustenance restricts their ability to deliver key micronutrients and other beneficial compounds to crops. We traded away quality in pursuit of quantity as modernized farming chased higher yields, overlooking a farmer's natural allies in the soil. As we'll see, mineral loss is not the whole story on nutritional quality, but so far it has received the most attention. Losing ground. Among the factors suspected or generally blamed, incorrectly, as we'll see, for declining mineral levels in crops is depletion of minerals from the soil itself. Far less controversial is the effect of crop breeding in trading off nutrient content for high yields, though it is not widely acknowledged beyond agricultural circles. This well-known reality has a name among agronomists and soil scientists: the dilution effect. Consider what happens when we breed crops for larger edible parts, bigger roots, fruits, or shoots. Picture a small fingerling potato next to a hefty russet, both grown in the same soil and that take up the same amount of iron. You'd be eating a different amount of iron in identical serving sizes of the two spuds. The smaller fingerling would contain more iron per bite than the russet, making the former more nutrient dense. Another case of the dilution effect occurs in wheat bred for higher yield. More seeds per seed head mean minerals are spread thinner. This is troubling as grains are both staples and particularly good sources for mineral micronutrients in the human diet. USDA agronomists who analyzed wheat varieties introduced from 1873 to 1995 found significant declines in iron, zinc, and selenium after conducting side-by-side field trials at two locations in Kansas. They concluded that crop breeding for higher yields reduced mineral micronutrient uptake, and that soil conditions also played a role. A similar study from Washington State University compared 63 historical and modern wheat varieties and found that higher-yielding modern types had significantly lower concentrations of copper, iron, magnesium, manganese, selenium, and zinc. Researchers in England came to a similar conclusion based on archived wheat samples from the Broadbalk Wheat Experiment, the world's longest-running agricultural field trial. They found that the concentrations of copper, iron, magnesium, and zinc remained stable from 1845 to about 1960, and then decreased significantly through 2005. They also measured the amount of mineral micronutrients in the soil, but found no evidence of depletion in the soil itself. They therefore concluded that the Green Revolution unintentionally decreased mineral density in wheat due to the introduction of high-yielding crop varieties. Reduced mineral content is not unique to wheat. An analysis of the changes in mineral composition of British fruits and vegetables from 1936 to the mid-1980s found statistically significant declines in calcium, magnesium, and copper in vegetables, and magnesium, iron, copper, and potassium in fruits. Phosphorus was the only mineral element that reportedly did not decrease over this period. Likewise, a 2004 comparison of published USDA food composition data from 1950 and 1999 across a group of 43 garden crops, 39 vegetables, 3 melons, and strawberries, found statistically robust declines in protein, calcium, phosphorus, and iron, as well as in vitamin B2, riboflavin, and vitamin C, ascorbic acid. While the study found substantial variability within each individual food, the mineral content of some foods actually increased. This was a clue that nutrient losses were not simply due to broad depletion of minerals in the soil. A subsequent review of food survey data from the 1930s and 1980s in the United States and the United Kingdom found major decreases in the average concentrations of copper, iron, and potassium in fruits. In vegetables, the average concentrations of copper and magnesium decreased in Britain, as did average concentrations of calcium, copper, and iron in the United States. A 2009 University of Texas study reviewed previous studies of declining nutrient levels in U.S. crops, concluded that there was strong evidence for 5 to 40% declines in the mineral content of fruits and vegetables over the previous half century. This study also noted that reported values of calcium in more than 24 commercial broccoli varieties were substantially lower than published USDA reference values, which themselves decreased by about 2/3 from 1950 to 2003. As the nutrition we expected our food to hold ratcheted down, we got less from growing more. While depletion of minerals in the soil is often identified as a likely culprit for declines in crops, a 2017 review of prior studies on nutrient declines found little evidence to support this interpretation. Instead, the review attributed the observed decline in crop mineral density to the introduction of new crop varieties. In the end, however, the author emphasized the benefits of higher yields on the global food supply and dismissed the importance of nutrient dilution effects, arguing that they could be offset through eating more fruits, vegetables, and whole grains. The message, apparently, was that nutrient depletion was simply the price to pay for high yields. But look at the problem of declining mineral levels another way, and perhaps the answer lies in moving minerals from soil into crops, rather than consuming more food that is less nutritious. A simple experiment. Can increasing levels of soil organic matter and rebuilding populations of microbes that act as nature's miners and truckers change mineral levels in crops? We had an opportunity to find out after presenting a public talk in southern Washington State when a soil conservationist with the Natural Resource Conservation Service relayed a natural experiment taking place on a farm just across the border in northern Oregon. A wheat farmer wanted to find out what would happen to yields on two adjacent fields under different methods of weed control. One method was the region's conventional practices: bare fields rotated with winter wheat and regular applications of the herbicide glyphosate. The other was a new practice for him: a complex crop rotation of spring barley, winter wheat, and a diverse mix of cover crops. The idea was to compare whether keeping the fields vegetated year-round could outcompete weeds without using herbicides. The farmer planted both with the same variety of wheat. He then fertilized with compost and a starter blend of chemical fertilizers. After 2 years, he had an answer to his yield question. Both fields produced a harvest of 75 bushels an acre. The cover crops suppressed weeds without reducing his harvest. But what about the mineral levels in the wheat? The farmer sent us samples to analyze, and the results intrigued us. He had added no supplemental mineral micronutrients to the no-till, no herbicide cover-cropped field. And yet, relative to the wheat grown under conventional practices, the wheat from the cover-cropped field had 35 to 56% more boron, manganese, and zinc, and 18 to 29% more copper, iron, and magnesium. These increases in mineral micronutrients were comparable in magnitude to reported historical nutrient declines. Yet you can't change the bulk chemistry of the soil in just a couple of years. Something else was going on, something important. What could change that fast? Soil biology, as it turns out. It seems that in planting cover crops and foregoing herbicides, the wheat farmer grew legions of underground microbes that ferried minerals from the earth into his harvest. 3. Living soil. Healthy citizens are the greatest asset any country can have. Winston Churchill. Suspicions about the influence of farming practices and soil health on the nutrient density of foods and human health date back almost a century. On March 22, 1939, a panel of 31 English physicians gathered at the Crewe Theatre in Cheshire to discuss the medical evidence and connections they saw between diet, farming, and health. The audience of hundreds included family doctors, farmers, politicians, and interested members of the rural public. The panel assessed the state of British medicine based on their own patient experiences and consultations with the region's family doctors. The evidence, laid out in a pamphlet supplemented with 28 pages of references, led them to propose that the accelerating use of chemical fertilizers and pesticides damaged human health. As he opened the meeting, the panel's chair praised the British healthcare system's progress in extending life expectancy. He noted how this mostly reflected greater public access to the services of his fellow physicians. But, he went on, the nationwide fall in fatality was all the more notable in view of the rise in sickness. The English were living longer, yet less healthy lives, and increasingly seeking treatment for readily preventable chronic maladies. What culprit did these doctors blame for undermining the 25-year-old National Health Insurance Act's goal of preventing and curing sickness and disease? The English diet. Their indictment centered on four well-known and prevalent English health conditions: bad teeth, rickets, anemia, and digestive disorders. In each case, the panel pointed to evidence of poor diet as the root cause. It wasn't that people lacked enough to eat. Their food lacked adequate nutrition. The panel cited a 1936 study of millions of English schoolchildren that found more than two-thirds had major dental problems. Genetic disposition could not explain the contrast to the nearly perfect teeth of the English population of Tristan da Cunha, an outpost of the British Empire in the South Atlantic. The panel also decried the annual scourge of thousands of cases of bone-softening rickets among English schoolchildren. Despite its prevention by right feeding being so easy that every dog breeder knows the means. Vitamin D is particularly important for preventing or treating rickets, as it enhances absorption of calcium and phosphorus, the two main components of bone. Eggs and fatty fish are good sources of vitamin D, and some foods, for example dairy products, are now fortified with it. Anemia ravaged poor children, and digestive disorders afflicted a sizable and growing proportion of the populace. The doctors ascribed these and many other ailments to nutritional deficiencies. They saw no way around it. The modern English diet was not healthy. The panel concluded that British doctors spent half their time on health conditions stemming from poor nutrition. They thought reducing human illness would require improving food quality, which in turn would come from restoring soil fertility. Confident as they were in what they were seeing, the doctors were less certain as to exactly what was missing from modern food. They pointedly did not advocate any particular diet, citing how healthy Eskimo, as they called the Inuit, lived on flesh, liver, blubber, and fish. The Hunza and Sikhs in India lived well on wheaten chapatis, fruits, milk, sprouted legumes, and a little meat. And the British inhabitants of Tristan da Cunha thrived on potatoes, seabirds' eggs, fish, and cabbage. In laying out their case, the doctors pointed to the common element among the diets of remarkably healthy peoples, a preponderance of fresh, whole, and minimally processed foods. Something was missing, they claimed, from England's working-class diet of white bread and boiled vegetables grown with chemical fertilizers. Drawing on veterinary medicine, they concluded that new Western diets and farming practices translated into nutritional deficiencies as surely in people as livestock. They considered it their duty to point out that much, perhaps most, of this sickness is preventable and would be prevented by the right feeding of our people. After the committee chair finished presenting the panel's findings, two prominent voices knighted for their work on food and agriculture backed up the doctor's testimony. Sir Robert McCarrison addressed what to eat, and Sir Albert Howard addressed how to grow it. After the presentations, the panel put the question of whether to endorse their conclusions to the audience. With little debate, the attendees unanimously carried a motion to accept the panel's assessment. Being English, the crowd then adjourned to the adjacent town hall for tea. McCarrison had spelled out what he saw as the big problems with the English diet: eating lots of processed flour, simple carbohydrates, and meat coupled with too few fresh vegetables. He also maintained that dairy intake was too low. Having performed groundbreaking experiments showing that diet and food quality influenced health, McCarrison set a scientific foundation for the panel's perspective. In the opening days of the 20th century, McCarrison served as a medical officer along the rugged Himalayan frontier in colonial India. The experience provided him with ample fodder for his later ideas about diet and health. In particular, he noticed striking differences in the physique and health of the region's inhabitants. Suspecting diet as the cause, he decided to experiment on rats, which eat pretty much anything people eat. McCarrison considered a year in the life of a rat akin to decades of a person's life. In just a few months' time, he thought he could glean meaningful insights into the lifelong effects of diet on human health. His rats thrived when he fed them the same foods people whose physique was good ate: whole wheat bread, milk, fresh vegetables, and pulses, the edible seeds of legumes like lentils, peas, and beans. For 2 years, he raised a group of rats on this diet and found they suffered no illness or death from natural causes, nor did they experience infant or maternal mortality. In stark contrast, another group of rats ate a diet with a minimum of milk and fresh vegetables, patterned after that of people whose physique was bad. These rats developed stomach, bowel, kidney, and bladder diseases, mirroring those of their human counterparts. Intrigued, McCarrison kept experimenting. He divided a group of juvenile rats into large cages where he kept everything the same except for their food. Rats in one group received a good diet, consisting of whole grains, milk, fresh vegetables, and occasional fresh meat. Those in the other group ate the typical English diet of white bread and margarine, tinned meat, vegetables boiled with soda, cheap tinned jam, tea, sugar, and a little milk. The difference proved striking. Rats raised on the good diet enjoyed physical and social health. Neither disease nor conflict plagued them. Those fed a typical English diet did not fare so well. Many became ill and began to fight. After 2 months, they started to kill and eat one another. McCarrison closed his remarks by noting that rats fed poor diets developed many of the same diseases that increasingly affected the English. To him, the lesson was clear. Diet mattered to health, and eating fresh whole foods was the diet that delivered. Sir Albert Howard, who also reaped enlightening insights working in India, spoke next. He argued that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.